importance of TQM for sustainable growth. I mean, Hiroshi Osada is one of the most renowned Japanese quality control author. He's written a book on Kaizen. He's going to be here. And you all know Ravichandran, Executive Director of CEO of Lucas TVS. He's going to chair. So we've got a number of programs lined up for you. Now, I think let's go to the program, what we lined up for you today. Most awaited program. I know at least the chief guest who is here, I think I'll walk miles with him. I heard him a couple of occasions earlier, one of the occasions in the MMA student convention. You're going to hear him today, and we got a feast of content this evening. Ladies and gentlemen, the talk for this evening, the Tata Group, from Torchbearers to Trailblazers. Success story, how it was done, is what we added, because this is what he's going to speak. And the book is authored by Shashank Shah. He is author, Tata Group, Win-Win Corporation, visiting scholar, Harvard Business School. And we also have one of the panelists joining the thing, and also will share his views, who has also worked in Tata Group for a very long time in TCS. Mr. Suresh Raman, our own Vice President, head of Chennai Operations, also Honorary Secretary of MMA. And the chief guest for this evening is Mr. Mukundan, Managing Director, Tata Chemicals Limited. Ladies and gentlemen, put your hand together to welcome our distinguished chief guest. Another thing, may I request Mr. Mukundan, Shashank, and please come and take your place on the dais. Yes, the format for this evening, before I said the book on which you're going to have all the discussions available for you on a nominal price, the right thing, I think it's a book worth being there in your library, worth reading it. And the format of the program this evening, I'll request Shashank to speak about the book and the content not in the book also, with a lot of anecdotes, which will make it interesting. Thereafter, Suresh will speak for a few minutes on his experience, Tata. There, we'll request the chief guest to release the book and hand over the first copy here to the gentleman on the dais. And then we'll request Mr. Mukundan to speak. Afterwards, we'll have a lot of Q&A session, because the speech, what is going to be delivered by the three stalwarts from the Tata Group, is going to incite a lot of lot of interest in you guys to have a lot of questions. Keep your questions ready. Before I call upon Shashank to come and speak on the book, let me briefly tell him a few words about him. Shashank is a thought leader, stakeholder-centric corporate strategy, corporate responsibility, value-centric leadership, with over 100 national and international publications to his credit. Research focus on the pivotal role of corporations in economic, social value, creation through visionary leadership, stakeholder-centric decision-making, inclusive business strategies. He has been a visiting scholar of Harvard Business School, fellow and project director of Harvard University South Asia Institute. And he has also done a number of other work, Outstanding Doctoral Management Student Award in IIM Ahmedabad. That requires a recognition. We have a round of clap, gentlemen. He's together from IIM Ahmedabad. Outstanding thing is, and he's a great TEDx speaker. And he's also addressed over hundreds of gathering of diverse themes. A highly acclaimed book, Sourceful Corporation, Win-Win Corporations, the Tata Group, were published by Springdale's and Penguin in 2014-16. And now I request Shashank to come and share your views on the books. And very warm welcome to Shashank. A round of applause for Shashank. Thank you.
A very warm good morning, good evening to all of you. Most of the sessions are in the morning, so I'm used to saying warm good morning. A warm good evening to all of you. It's truly very warm here in Chennai, and I'm sure everyone is looking forward to the first bout of rains to enable us to experience the freshness of the setting in of the monsoon. It's an honor being here at the Madras Management Association. I thank Group Captain Vijay Kumar and his team for inviting me for this session on the Tata Group book. I'm also grateful to Mr. Mukundan, the Managing Director of Tata Chemicals, for accepting our request to become the chief guest for this event, and also to Mr. Suresh Raman to be the guest of honor for today's event. So let me begin with a small story and then take you through several aspects of the Tata Group and a few anecdotes which form the basis of what I think and why I have written what I have written. A caveat is that this book is not commissioned by the Tata Group. It's an outcome of 10 years of my research and interactions with over 100 Tata leaders, right from Mr. Ratan Tata all the way to shop floor factory and shop floor leaders in Jamshedpur, Pune, and several other places. I had the privilege also to interview Mr. Mukundan and several of the managing directors of Tata companies. So this conversation was shared with me by one of my professors at the Harvard Business School. This goes back about 20 years when Mr. Ratan Tata had taken over as the chairman. And one of the key questions which was confabulating a lot of people was that why is the Tata Group venturing to go global when the Indian markets have opened up for international companies? Most of the companies was focusing on managing the competition in their own borders, and here is Mr. Tata venturing to go overseas. So one of these professors from Harvard had asked him this question in a personal conversation. And then the answer which he gave is very insightful. He said, in the next couple of decades, we see India growing at about 10%. Of these, the opportunities that the Tata Group would be able to make the most of would be just 6%. 4% of the opportunities would be those that the Tata values would not permit us to explore or exploit. Hence, it is imperative for us to ensure that if we want to grow at par with what the nation is growing, we should explore opportunities overseas. I think it is this uniqueness of the Tata Group of placing values as a primary precondition for undertaking every business activity, of placing the society before commercial success, and of focusing on industry playing a catalytic role for the country, I was truly inspired to study this group. Let me not limit this example to what Mr. Ratan Tata shared with that professor on that particular day. Let me go back to examples from the lives of a few of the previous chairmen and see how they had done similar things much ahead of their time in the years they were leading the Tata Group of companies. In the year 1922, Tata Steel was going through very tough times. World War I had just concluded, and the British Raj had opened up the Indian markets, and there was a lot of steel dumping. In the previous decade, Tata Steel had been of immense help to the British government by manufacturing nearly 3 lakh tons of steel and 2,400 kilometers of railway to facilitate the Allied forces in World War I. But the antithetical treatment to that was that once the war was over, the British government opened the market, there was steel dumping, and Tata Steel was in tough times, almost at the nadir of their performance, on the verge of being closed down, which several people recommended. And Mr. R.D. Tata, who is the father of JRD and one of the four founders of the Tata Group, is believed to have said that Tata Steel will close down only over my dead body. How would they then manage the kind of financial constraints that they were facing? And what Dorabji Tata, who was then chairman of the Tata Group, the son of Jamshedji, and who led the Tata Group for 25 years, did something which has since then remained an example for corporations. He mortgaged his wife's jewelry and also the Jubilee diamond, which was twice the size of Kohinoor, which was his possession, and raised a loan from the Imperial Bank of India, now the State Bank of India, of 1 crore so that he could manage the working capital requirements and pay wages to the laborers at Tata Steel. This example is even more striking in today's times, when in difficult situations, the first thing that founders of several companies have done is to find themselves a good island where India does not have a reciprocative immigration arrangement, and park themselves there and keep on fighting a legal battle for as many years as they can delay their arrival to India. This example of Dorabji is a shining example of the whole purpose for which corporations had begun, to play a catalytic role in society. It just didn't end with that. The Tata Steel story is a fabulous story, despite the ups and downs in the financial situation. Is around 1992, Tata Steel was the most expensive manufacturer of steel in the world. But over the next 15 years, what they did was fantastic. They became not only the lowest cost producer of steel in the world, not only did they successfully manage to lay off 40,000 employees in a brilliant way such that there was no strife on the shop floor, not only did they become India's first Fortune 500 company, but they also became the only steel company in the world to win the Deming Grand Prize, which is like the Nobel Prize in the field of total quality. That's the kind of transition, and these are the kind of companies we are talking about, and I have elaborated in the book. Another example of our very own JRD Tata, and I call him our very own, he's one of the award winners at IMMA I saw in that list. He was also always referred to as Apro JRD, Apro meaning ours in Gujarati, because that was his mother tongue. And he is someone who is always looked up to very fondly for the very humane personality he had. So let's go back to the 1960s and 70s. Personal taxation in India had gone up by 450%. The tax slab had reached almost 45% tax, plus a 50% super profit tax. The highest tax bracket ended up going to 97.5%. To add to that wealth tax, and you ended up paying 105% tax for every 100 rupees earned. So the millennials who complain today about the tax system and everything to do with GST can imagine that for every 100 rupees you have earned, you don't only give that to the government, you also give 5 rupees from your savings. At such point in time, JRD's constant debate with his accountants would not be about tax avoidance or tax management, as they used to call it, but tax compliance. In fact, once one of his company's accountants ventured to do something which would save taxes for the Tata Group, the chairman of that company took this particular accountant to JRD along with Mr. Dinesh Vyas, who was an eminent tax consultant from India in those years. And the first question the first thing Dinesh Vyas told JRD, "But sir, this is not illegal." JRD said, "That's not my question. Is it the right thing to do in the interest of the nation? That is my question." That is the kind of conversations we are talking about that happened in the Tata boardrooms in those years. And that's a trend which continues even today, as I gave the example of Mr. Ratan Tata. More interestingly, in such a scenario when the tax rates were anyway so high, JRD took the unprecedented step of mandating corporate social responsibility expenditure by most leading Tata companies by modifying their articles of association and making it a core objective of key Tata companies like Tata Chemicals, Tata Motors, and Tata Steel way back in the 1960s. So you not only end up paying 105% tax, but you also end up spending a fixed amount of money regularly, irrespective of the profits you make, so that you discharge your role in the area of corporate social responsibility. This field of corporate social responsibility has achieved so much of importance in contemporary times after the New Companies Act. The spotlight was thrown on 2% mandatory CSR. But very few people know, and it was a revelation to me, that 125 years ago, it was Jamsetji Tata who had first suggested or proposed that a fixed percent of tax of profits from Empress Mills should be spent for investing in the upcoming scheme on the Indian Institute of Science. The shareholders declined that suggestion, and Mr. Tata was quite upset. What we know subsequently he did do was bequeathed 14 properties of his and 4 plots of land, which amounted to 50% of his personal wealth, to the establishment of the IISc. But 125 years later, that suggestion of Jamsetji has today thrown the spotlight on CSR and the role that CSR can play in contributing to social well-being. An interesting aspect of IISc, which we rarely know, is why is it called IISc? Why is it not called the Tata Institute of Science? In today's times, where even elevators within business schools in the world have boards as to we are grateful to the donor of this particular elevator for their munificence, why isn't there the name Jamsetji Tata or Tata added to the Indian Institute of Science? Because in his will, Mr. Jamsetji Tata had mentioned specifically that I do not want this institution to be named after me, but after India, because every Indian should feel that this institution belongs to him and it is not an institution established in memory of the founder donor who contributed 50% of his wealth for the establishment of this institution. Today, the word strategic philanthropy is very, very much in discussion in the management circles. Jamsetji Tata's philanthropy was also strategic philanthropy. But while today's strategic philanthropy talks about the benefits for the donor, Jamsetji's strategic philanthropy spoke about the benefits to the nation. That was true strategic philanthropy he was talking about. Taking it beyond that into the field of business, he was no doubt among the richest Indians of his times and the first to have a house with non-stop electricity. But he extended that and wanted to provide clean energy to his favorite city, which was Bombay. Clean energy, a term which is in management jargon was in the last 5 years, was envisaged by Jamsetji 150 years ago, 7 years before the first hydroelectric plant came up in the world in Wisconsin in USA. Jamsetji Tata was talking about hydroelectricity power generation for the city of Bombay. It's a different thing that the Tata Power Company came up 40 years later because the British Raj did not give him permission to start those projects, just as they did not give him permission for 25 years to start exploring for the appropriate mines so that the steel making business could begin. So there are examples and examples, and I gave you examples from four chairmen's lives of what distinguishes the Tata way of business. Tatas usually are considered a gold standard in ethics, in social responsibility. We talk about IISc, TIFR and BARC are the cradles of India's nuclear power. We talk about Tata Institute of Social Science, which is the Asia's first social work university. We talk about the Tata Memorial Hospital, which is Asia's largest integrated cancer care hospital, which is now spearheading 100 more across India under its mentorship. We talk about Tatas in the light of all these great social contributions. But we rarely talk about Tatas as a structure worthy of emulation. Very few people, and this came up a lot during the recent Ambani wedding, where there were a lot of discussions on who is the richest Indian, etc., and which is the most value creating or most valued group in India, etc. And that time there were a lot of misnomers in the society, in the media, that Reliance is the most valued group as a conglomerate. And then the question was, if Tata's is the most valued group, why isn't Ratan Tata the richest businessman in India, and so on and so forth. If you go to Quora even today, these are the questions which millennials are asking, because the notion or the understanding usually is like the Premji's own almost 70% plus of Wipro and the Ambani's own almost 50% plus of Reliance. Mr. Tata must be owning the Tata group to that extent. But very few know that the Tata structure, and permit me some 30-40 seconds to explain that, because I'm sure a lot of finance professionals would be here, and because it's being telecast live, several hundreds would be watching it across Tamil Nadu. The Tata Group companies are at the base, about 100 of them, 25 listed, about 75 privately held. They are owned by Tata Sons to the extent of 25 to 75%, the listed companies. The privately held are fully owned by them. Tata Sons in exchange is owned by the Tata Trust to the tune of 67%. Now, Tata Trust being public charitable trust, 85% of the Tata Trust earnings are meant to be spent for social well-being. So whatever dividends the Tata companies give go to Tata Sons in that proportion. And Tata Sons dividends, 67% after reinvestments in businesses, go to that proportion to the Tata Trust. And that money, 85% of that, comes back to India. So this is a model of what most leading business schools have called a cycle of virtuous wealth creation. And it's an implementation of Jamsetji's vision that what comes from the society should go back to the society several times over. This is not a model which was started last decade or by Mr. Ratan Tata. This is a model which has been in existence for almost 100 years and was primarily started by Dorabji and Sir Ratan Tata, the sons of Jamsetji Tata, when they bequeathed their entire holding or big chunk of their holding to the Tata Trusts, which today accounts for almost 55%. So in my interactions with most Tata leaders, when I ask them, what motivates you? Because the philosophy with Tata is, or it was always been in the earlier years, that in Hindi they say, Juta ho to Bata ka, or Naukri ho to Tata ka. So if you wear a shoe, you should wear the Bata brand. And if you're having a job, it should be with the Tata group. So when I interviewed these 100 plus leaders, I asked them, why and what motivates you? Why are you a part of this group? And most of them would say, I'm a second generation Tata employee, et cetera, or I'm a third generation Tata employee. In Tata Steel, you'll find even fourth generation employees working. Most of them said this, we come to office every day morning with the conviction that our work, our efficiency and contribution is not for increasing the net worth of the founders and promoters of this group, but all that we do will ultimately go towards the well-being of India. That motivates us to invest every single day to the best of our abilities. And as a matter of trivia, Mr. Ratan Tata owns just 0.8% of Tata Sons. That's all his personal ownership. And that's why he isn't the richest man in India, though Tata Group is the most valued conglomerate. But the problem with the researchers is that Tata Group has been left aside as a great gold standard in ethics and responsibility, and hence it's a good company, but it doesn't make a lot of money for its shareholders. It may not be a very corporate shrewd company, and these are the kind of wrong notions that have been for long held by several generations who haven't ventured to study the Tatas in detail. Most of the books on the Tatas till now, and why I wanted to write was also for this reason, have focused on the sociological perspective of the Tatas or the leadership ideals of its founders. What they haven't focused on is the core business promise that the Tata Group brings forth and how they have done business with a difference and have also run their companies extremely profitably. Otherwise, they would not have been where they are today. Permit me to elaborate on that a bit. In the mid-90s, there was a group of multinational executives from several countries who had come as part of the Harvard Business School Executive Education Program to India. Mr. Ratan Tata had just taken over as the chairman. And so he was presenting the Tata Group before them. And then usually in the Harvard model, you have a Q&A thing at the end of the case presentation. So most of them were asking him questions and they started even advising him because he was a chairman who had just taken over India's largest industrial group. So they said, in our opinion, the Tata Group in its current format is not going to survive in a liberalized India. You must consider selling off most of your large legacy companies and focus on one or two areas. The first company they suggested to sell off was Tata Steel. They said it is an antiquated company in a sunset industry and several of its kind you should do away with because Daewoo has not done well in Korea. The Salim Group is struggling in Indonesia. We don't see much hope for the Tata Group. Thankfully, Mr. Ratan Tata listened to them but did not implement their ideas, took it as a challenge, and in the subsequent 25 years, the Tata Group has grown 25x. From a revenue of 24,000 crores in 1992, it grew to a revenue of 6,50,000 crores by 2017, of which 67% was coming from outside India. Now, how do they make commercial sense? First of all, I said it is India's largest and most globalized conglomerate. Secondly, if you would combine all the Tata companies together, it would be the 49th largest company in the world with a market cap of 10 trillion rupees. A trivia question for you, and I will answer that. Which is the largest employer in India? I asked that yesterday at TCS, and I didn't get the right answer, so I'm Indian Railways. Okay, this side? TCS, one more answer. Okay, so this is what happened even yesterday. We forget the agencies who are enabling us to sit in this air-conditioned auditorium and struggling in the deserts of Rajasthan and the snow peaks of Siachen in order to ensure that India is safe. The Indian Defense Forces are the largest employer in India. Second is Indian Railways, and third is the Tata Group with 7.24 lakh employees. When I wrote the book, it was 7 lakh, but like India's population ticks every day, the Tata's size keeps increasing every month, and now there are 7,24,000, of which 4,24,000 are right here in TCS, and Mr. Suresh Raman here in Chennai houses about 70,000 of them. What is even more interesting is that TCS is India's largest employer, private sector employer of women. There are 1,40,000 women in TCS. That's a fantastic transition from the days when Mrs. Sudha Murthy wrote to JRD Tata on a postcard that it is not fair for a visionary company like Tata's to prevent employment for women in their companies. Another interesting fact file. What is the quantum of taxes that the Tata Group pays in a time when the left of center conversation in most universities is that corporates are a force for evil and hence they should not be allowed to succeed? A brief analysis gave me the figures that the Tatas contribute about 2.25% of India's taxes, which is a whopping 47,000 crores, which is the tax collection of Himachal, Assam, Odisha, and Goa put together is the tax contribution of the Tata Group alone. And they contribute 4% of India's GDP. So we are talking about an entity which has such phenomenal size. It could be, like yesterday Mr. Suresh Raman's team was sharing with me, the employee base of the TCS is larger than the population of Barbados as a country. So we are talking about these kinds of sizes, and the valuation of TCS is larger than the valuation of the stock exchange of Pakistan. So you're talking about figures at that stage. The last part on this before I go to some small anecdotes is about the financial part. Do Tatas create wealth for their shareholders? I've been writing often on LinkedIn based on my book and my research, and this is the question people ask very often. So what did I do? I did a study where I took 16 leading Tata companies between 1992 and 2017. I took a notional amount of 1 lakh rupees, divided equally among these 16 companies, and analyzed their contribution for shareholder wealth creation over 25 years. The same analysis was done for BSE and Nifty companies. The 1 lakh invested in BSE and Nifty gave a return of 10 lakhs after 25 years. The 1 lakh equally invested in these 16 Tata companies gave a return of 40 lakhs at the end of 25 years. So there was 4x the wealth creation compared to Sensex and Nifty. Secondly, I compared their returns to shareholders with Siemens, GE and Mitsubishi, the largest conglomerates in US, in Europe and in Japan. And the Tatas had created greater wealth for their shareholders than these conglomerates had in their own countries. I compared Tata's performance with their peers of their size and scale, Reliance and Birla. And between 2007 and 17, post the financial crisis years, Tata Group had created more wealth for their shareholders than Reliance and Birla. And the most fascinating fact file was that in these 25 years, Tatas had created more wealth for their shareholders than even Berkshire Hathaway under the phenomenal investor Warren Buffett. I have put this upfront in the book, so there's this entire analysis on finance not being up to the mark, and hence all the good work done by the group of companies being a matter of discussion was laid to rest in the book in the first few chapters itself, because when these fact files, and these are based on figures from Bloomberg and several databases both from Harvard and India, which helped me put all of this together. Now let me take you to the last part of my presentation. We've talked about their structure, we've talked about their history, we talked about some phenomenal fact files about how they have done business and done really well, definitely in the last 25 years, but truly commendable in the difficult years under the British Raj and under the License Raj, when private sector companies were not allowed to grow. Tata Steel grew from 0.5 million tons per annum to 1 million tons per annum in 40 years. You compare that with some of the Japanese companies in the same period, they have grown to nearly 20, 30, 40 million tons per annum. Cumulatively, the Japanese industry, steel industry's manufacturing capacity increased to 100 million tons per annum, and we were handcuffed to the License Raj. So let me talk about three or four key stakeholders, which are vital in any business, and how there are examples from Tata companies of how they are dealt with in a unique way, in a way that is a little different, and I'm sure which is worthy of emulation. Let me take the example. So you want an example from TCS or Tata Motors?
Tata Motors,
okay. So I'll take you to the times of Mr. Suman Mulgaonkaran, because the book captures 150 years. What I have tried to do is not only talk about the chairman, who have definitely played an important role, but also talk about leaders at each level across generations who have played a very important role in their respective companies. Suman Mulgaonkar was one such visionary. He was the chairman of Tata Motors and who led that group and the automobile revolution in a phenomenal way. Very few know that Mrs. Indira Gandhi had requested JRD to permit Suman Mulgaonkar to be the chairman of Maruti Udyog in the initial years. And he in turn sent R.C. Bhargava and others overseas to look for collaborations, and they got the collaboration with Suzuki. So this is the time when trucks in India had non-synchronous gearboxes. A committee was set up because the chairman wanted synchronous gearboxes for their trucks. Now these had to be imported. The customer was not going to pay more. So the committee suggested to the chairman that we should not go for this because the company will end up paying for these and we do not want to venture into that field. So Mr. Mulgaonkar called a meeting, he spoke to all of them, he listened to their suggestions, and then in the end he asked, how many of you have driven a truck for 3 days? Nobody raised their hand. Then he asked, how many of you have driven a truck at least for 1 day for 12 hours continuously? Nobody raised their hands. He said, first go and drive a truck for 1 day for 12 hours, then extrapolate the effort that truck drivers have to make to drive the same truck using our non-synchronous gears for 300 days in a year, 12 hours a day across the Indian roads of those years. So there was pin drop silence in the meeting room. Then Mr. Suman Mulgaonkar said, it is not important whether we have to bear the cost of that gearbox or the customer will bear. What is important is the customer for us, who is a truck driver, should have a delightful experience while driving Tata trucks because he is our ambassador. This is at a time not when Tatas were facing competition, but at a time when the erstwhile telco had 75% monopoly in the market. You can imagine the mindset of a company with 75% monopoly. A couple of years later, there was a premium of 40,000 rupees in the market. You had to wait for 10 years and a 40,000 rupees premium for Tata trucks. So someone suggested within the team again that, Mr. Mulgaonkar, we should consider raising the prices of our trucks, because if people are willing to pay 40,000 rupees premium, they'll be willing to buy a little more expensive truck. Mr. Mulgaonkar's words are really worthy of reflection in the business schools of today. He said, profits should not come by exploiting a monopoly situation in the market. Profits should come by improving productivity and efficiency within the company. Customer affection is any company's greatest asset. These are the words Mr. Mulgaonkar had uttered 40 years ago. Customer affection is a term that's come in the management jargon in the last half a decade. Here we are talking about customer affection 40 years ago. That's why they were much ahead of their times. Let me talk about Taj Hotels. It's the ambassador of Indian hospitality, and they call themselves as the true representative of the Sanskrit maxim, Atithi Devo Bhava, guest is God. And we witnessed that when there were terror attacks at the Taj Hotels in Mumbai, that while in several other places, the employees of the respective companies ran away from their premises, here the Taj Hotel employees formed human chains and protected 1,200 customers in that particular hotel and gave up their lives. Incidentally, I also lost my neighbors, both husband and wife, in the terror attack on 26/11, and two of their daughters and the grandparents were there, and today the daughters are in high school, but these can be really traumatic moments. But talking about Taj Hotels and how employees as a stakeholder should be taken care of, this story goes back to JRD's years. There was a theft in Taj, and through all the processes, the manager in charge had identified the culprits and had charged them with theft. JRD was always the last resort for any of such resolution matters for resolution. So these employees wrote a letter directly to JRD for his intervention. That particular day, JRD had completed 50 years as the chairman of Taj Hotels. He participated in the celebrations in the morning. In the afternoon, he presided over this meeting where those two apparent employees charged with theft and the manager were there. JRD took an hour, went through all the papers, finally told the manager, your decision is right. These two have committed theft. They should be relieved from the job. Those two were told to leave. They moved out of the room. JRD indicated to the manager to stay back. And then JRD Tata told that manager, please find out if these two employees have any school-going children. If they have school-going children, then the responsibility of educating them till they complete college should be taken up by the Tata group, because they should not pay the price of their father's follies. This is called the Tata way of business. And this was seen in action on several occasions in several companies, whether it was JRD or any of the other leaders. Another example which became a butt of the jokes in the corporate circles was Tata Steel's separation scheme. As I mentioned, they cut down their employee base by 40,000. I'll just take 5 minutes, I'll conclude. There's some very interesting stories. They cut down their employee base by 40,000. And this is in Jharkhand and Bihar, where around the same period there have been 6,000 deaths. So you can, in all kinds of violent clashes. But the Tatas haven't ever lost a single employee. In fact, they go to places to do social service where even the government sometimes finds it difficult. So how did they manage to ensure that 40,000 people were relieved? They established what was called, or they started what was called, the early separation scheme, devised by the HR. Dr. Jamshed Irani, he shared with me, he was the managing director in those years, another stalwart of the Tata ecosystem. He said that the ESS had three unique characteristics. 1.2 to 1.5 times your current salary till your notional date of retirement. If you are 45 and you are relieved, till you are 60, you will continue to get 1.2 to 1.5 times of your salary, sit at home. You will get lifetime health care and medical insurance free. And for 3 years, you can stay in Jamshedpur till you find an alternative home. If you find another job, you can earn from that and the money that we are giving you. We have no problems. So the corporate circle said, Jamshed, the Tatas either have too much money or too little brains. Who gives early separation schemes of this kind? So Jamshed Irani said, this is our experiment with labor welfare. Let us see what the results are. Over the next 15 years, I shared with you their financial success. But in 2010, when Forbes came up with a book called The 10 Best Industrial Decisions of All Times, there was only one Indian company which was featured there, which was Tata Steel. And the decision why they were featured there by Forbes was by relieving 40,000 employees without any anguish, without any violence, without any displeasure. In fact, on the day of exit, the employees used to celebrate by having a feast saying, we are grateful to the Tatas for the way they have treated us. So this is the Tata way of business. Customers, employees, supply chain. When I addressed the annual convention of MMA, I gave the example of Titan's experiment with the Karigar parks, of how they have redefined the life of their Karigars. I gave the example of Tata Chemicals and their More Pulses project, which has played a catalytic role in the pulses market in India. Talking about shareholders, I shared how they have created wealth. But a very interesting aspect of the shareholders is the TCS story. I narrated half of it yesterday at TCS, and I will share the remaining half. One point was that why wasn't TCS listed as an IPO during the IT boom? Everybody has that question. 97,000 crores was the valuation that Credit Suisse First Boston had given. If they would have gone for it and sold a small proportion of their holdings, about 20,000 crores, they could have got Tata Chemicals, Tata Power, Tata Steel, and Tata Motors in 100% ownership, which was one of the key priorities of Mr. Ratan Tata when he took over as chairman. Because in those years, Birla owned more of Tata Steel than Tata's. Birla owned 6%, Tata owned 3%. That was the kind of ownership. So the proposal went to Mr. Ratan Tata. Mr. Sunawala was the vice chairman, asked him, and this is again, I've got a first-person account, that this is the kind of valuation, can we go ahead? Or would you like to consider? So Mr. Ratan Tata said, yes, I agree that this is a phenomenal valuation. But we all know that this is the IT boom. Tomorrow, the situation may not be the same. And the dividends that shareholders will get for the kind of investments they have made in today's prices will not be proportional. They will hold that against us. And I do not want the shareholders to think that Tata Group has taken advantage of a situation to list their IPO. They finally listed the IPO at the nadir of the economic cycle in 2004, when the Vajpayee government fell and the Bombay Stock Exchange collapsed by 25%. That's when TCS was, IPO was listed. Today it is India's most valued company in 15 years. So performance speaks louder than the timing of your IPO. But one interesting fact which nobody knows and which is first time covered in my book is how Tata's took care of a key shareholder of theirs while the IPO listing was happening. So first they presumed that since Tata Sons owns TCS, so when the IPO goes live and the Tata Sons gets its shares, automatically the shareholders of Tata Sons will benefit. But then they realized on evaluation that there will be a discounting factor which will creep in when the dividends come in, and the shareholders of Tata Sons will not benefit to the same extent if they would have owned the shares of TCS directly. So then they decided, okay, the first preference should be shareholders of Tata Sons to acquire TCS shares. The question then came is, the biggest shareholder is Tata Trusts. Tata Trust is not permitted by law since 1983 to buy public private company shares as per legislation. So how do you ensure that Tata Trust get their shares? Someone else in some other organization, it would have been that, okay, it's okay, after all, it's a charitable organization. We will ensure that they benefit, but we don't want to get into this problem. Tata Sons decided on another approach. They found out that while public charitable trust cannot buy shares from of a private company, but they can accept as gift shares of a private company. So Tata Sons gave a gift of 6.5% of TCS shares to Tata Trusts so that they could benefit from the dividends and the money that would come from there. Now at that time, Tata Sons had a liability of 9,000 crores. If they would have not done that, they would have improved their balance sheet. They would have had a better borrowing capacity. But they didn't do that. They ensured that TCS gets their share of the shares. TCS ended up selling those shares after the IPO was listed, and they got Tata Trusts got 5,000 crores by selling TCS shares, which was added to their corpus, which was ultimately used for social welfare. So caring for the shareholders does not mean caring only for the shareholders who have financially invested. In Tata's, the largest shareholder is not anybody else but India itself through its society, which is represented through the Tata Trust. I'll conclude with this point where this question is often asked. Are Tata's businessmen or industrialists? This is a new conversation again. If you go on Google, this comes up very often. Then usually people say, no, they are industrialists because they're focused on industry and not on just making money through business. In my book, I go one step further and say, no, they are not industrialists also. They are nation builders. Because they did not focus on industry and its growth. They used industry to play a catalytic role in nation building. Because the kind of industries they invested in had to wait 20, 25 years before the first rupee of profit was made. And one shining example is Tata Chemicals. It took almost 2 decades in the World War II and post-World War II scenario for Tata Chemicals to turn positive. But the focus was that India needs a chemical company for its own industrial growth, and they invested in that. So the ideal of trusteeship, which first has been propounded in the Isha Upanishad, in the verse, Tena Tyaktena Bunjita Ma Gridha Kasya Svidhanam, all the wealth that we own is God's gift to us. We should use that much as our requirements are and use the rest for the benefit of society. And which was popularized by Mahatma Gandhi in the freedom struggle as the role of industrialists. Many have done that in their personal capacity, but Tatas have institutionalized the model of trusteeship through their labor welfare programs, through their responsibility to society, through an ethical approach to business where the Tata Code of Conduct weaves together, synergizes the Tata companies as one identity, and through establishing a symbiotic relationship between business and society where each exists for the other. That's why I've called them from torchbearers to trailblazers. Not only are they torchbearers of the ideal of Humta, Hukta and Huvrashtra, which are the watchwords of Zoroastrian faith from which Jamsetji had originally come. Not only have they been torchbearers of trusteeship, which came from the Sanatana Dharma, not only have they been the torchbearers of industrial patriotism, where industrial self-sufficiency was considered a precondition for India's political independence, but they have also been trailblazers in the fields of globalization, business excellence, and innovation, and are today India's most well-known global brand and the most valued brand in India at $19.5 billion. In this book, you will find scores of stories telling us how business can be done the Tata way and how several other entrepreneurs, startups, and small and medium-sized companies can learn from the Tatas. It is not all positive. There are mistakes they have made. There are failures. There are downturns. I have highlighted them. In the next print of the book, which is coming up in July, Mr. Ratan Tata has kindly penned the foreword, and he has mentioned that I am happy that Shashank has covered both the pros and cons, because there is enormous learning even in the mistakes that we make if we rectify them and get back on the right path we had originally envisaged. So thank you so much for this opportunity.
Thank you, Shashank. It's a very inspiring story. We should be proud Tata's Indian company. Now, it occurs to Suresh. Suresh, you all know Suresh is the Honorary Secretary of MMA and also the Vice President, Head of Chennai Operations. He then is a master's from BITS Pilani, and he's been with TCS more than 25 years. You'll have a very interesting anecdote to share with us. Over to Suresh.
Good evening to all of you. So I was just wondering whether I belong to the Tata Group or Shashank Shah, Dr. Shashank Shah belongs to Tata Group. Frankly, he knows more about Tata probably than me. And the book also, when I realized what all I didn't know. And though I knew a lot of stories over the last more than 2.5 decades or 3 decades, but I realized probably he knows more than me, definitely. So I think I have to acknowledge that, Dr. Shashank Shah. And it was a very, very, I think, touching speech and a lot of anecdotes. When I read the book, I was looking at all the anecdotes, all the examples, some of the examples he spoke. I request all of you to read it because it inspires for us to be good citizens of the country. I think that's what I realized. He talked about nation building. And the other thing, he talked about highs and lows, and important to also look at what are the success and failures also. So I think very important lessons from a management perspective also. Now, a lot of success he talked about, a couple of fear and from few failures also there. I think that's important for us to look at. And also the underlying philosophy, and he talks about a lot of data points also he has given actually in the book. I think very important for us to understand how he has derived it, not just by interviewing people, but also looked at a lot of data points, which some of them he articulated today. And a lot of inflection points in the Tata Group he also lays down, and how things changed from one generation of Tata to another, etc. And relating to my experience over the last nearly 3 decades now, I also, in fact, recently we had this Tata Central Archives mobile exhibition of Jamshedji Tata. So, in fact, I also learned a lot from that, how one of the critical examples, before I talk about TCS, one thing I learned about this Indian Institute of Science, he talked about, very important anecdote which came to me from the people there, is about how British mocked the idea of Indian Institute of Science in the early 1900s. So they said, when you start a science and engineering institute of this magnitude, which is not prevalent in the US as well, who will first study? Okay, the second question was who will teach? And the third question was where are the jobs? I think and that he went against the odds and he wanted to do it. Of course, his sons took it over. That's what he was saying. Very important to understand the context on which the whole Indian Institute of Science was thought was really amazing. And coming to our TCS perspective, I think all of you know the father of software industry, Mr. F.C. Dr. F.C. Kohli. And in fact, the tough times when we started in 1968, thinking about management consulting and IT industry in India was never thought of. And interestingly, a lot of struggles were there against the government policies, which never allowed us to even import a mainframe computer, because they said even the largest banks of India don't have a mainframe. So what are you going to do with the mainframe? A lot of interesting stories and anecdotes there in TCS as well. And we did in 1978 the PAN. You're talking about the permanent account number of income tax that was designed by TCS in the 1970s. And if you really look at it, we also went ahead to give proposals to the government of India that we can order, do a lot of automation, computerization of the finance ministry, the income tax department, and the prime minister and the then prime ministers, etc. The rest felt the computers will throw away jobs. And that's what I realized in 1980s also when I used to go to banks. A lot of unions used to say when computer comes into the bank, a lot of jobs will be lost. But you can see the number of bank employees today versus 1980s. As I don't know, I don't think really jobs have been lost, only the skills have changed. I think that's what is the belief on which TCS still runs, because we're doing a lot of digital transformation engagements across the globe. People talk about AI, ML, we talk about automation. End of the day, it's all about change of skills which is happening in every few generations. I think this is very interesting generations, interesting time ahead, because we have to be prepared for this new age and reskill ourselves, upskill ourselves, and that is the only way we can dominate the world. And that's and similarly, we did this passport project, and you can see the difference which we have done. I think it's not about the profitability of the project, but it's the question of nation building. Again, we have contributed from our side in TCS. A lot of healthcare and hospital management systems projects we have done across many hospitals in India. And importantly, the major stock exchanges automation was done by us. I think the type of complexity in our transactions in stock exchange, you can imagine. It's huge stock exchanges comparable or even bigger than some of the largest stock exchanges in the world. And in TCS, we talk about few things like fit for life, purpose for life, learn for life, philosophy, extending the philosophy of Tata Group. We want people to be fit. We want people to contribute to society. That's what purpose for life. And we want people to continuously learn. So that's what we call learn for life. Because in today's age, if you don't learn, you're gone, right? So very important for us to have these underlying philosophies of the Tata Group merge with us. If you look at each of the people who have run the TCS as an enterprise for the last 50 plus years now, Dr. Kohli was the father of software industry I talked about. He believed that India's talent is there. It's up to us to leverage it. And he feels that we have really not at all utilized our talent even now. When we say that he has done a lot for us because we have generated so much of IT employment in India, he says we have just scratched the surface. The Indian potential is very, very high. That's a remark even now we made when we came for the Industrial Economist Golden Jubilee, right, celebrations. So I think very interesting. And Mr. Ramadurai, who took over from him, was an institutional builder. He also was the chairman of the National Skill Development Corporation. And then we had Mr. Chandrasekharan, who was the current chairman. The passion and pride he brought into the company, in the group now, and always thinking big, and a belief in talent. Again, he used to talk about realize your potential as a major thing. So very important philosophies on which we have built on further. And today we have our CEO, Rajesh Gopinathan. He's driving the digital transformation. Last 3 years, we can see how we have performed, how the stock market is reacting to us, how the world global market is reacting to us. When everybody said the IT industry is going to be down 2-3 years ago, and TCS was the only company in India which stayed positive, and you can see the results now. So I think end of the day, I think from a perspective of all the Tata Group as well as TCS, one thing commonly I see is the founders, the chairman of the companies and CEOs of the companies, including Mr. Mukundan, they all see the future and clearly have good succession plans in each of the companies. And in all the companies, especially in TCS, I can see the learning and sharing is of prime importance. And the risk-taking ability, because we want to be pioneers in what we do. And the integrity and the customer centricity as our major focus. And he talked about, we employ about women employees, about 150,000 people in TCS. And in Chennai, we have 70,000. Out of that, 42% or 43% is women. I think this very good stories we have. I can go on and on. But since I'm a familiar face in MMA, being the secretary, I would like to get all of you to listen to Mr. Mukundan. Thanks a lot.
Thank you, Suresh. This is now waiting for our most important event of the event. This evening, may I request the chief guest step forward, do the honor of releasing the book and hand over the first copy to gentlemen on the dais. Thank you. Thank you, sir, for doing us the honor. You all know Mukundan doesn't need introduction, my privilege. He's done his graduation from IIT Roorkee, then thereafter his master's from Delhi University, then he's from Tata Administrative Service in 1990. He's a chairman, he's a managing director and CEO of Tata Chemicals, one of the best known companies, always in news and thing for so many renovations which is happening today. And I will request to Mr. Mukundan, please address the gathering. Over to Mr. Mukundan.
Good evening, Vanakkam, Namaskaram. I'm really delighted to be in Chennai. I never refuse an opportunity to when I'm invited here, because I can then visit my parents on the way back. That's really one of the main reasons I never say no to coming to Chennai. But this is a special occasion. I want to thank Group Captain Vijay Kumar for hosting this important event. It's a terrific event. But I want to tell you this terrific work you're doing. When you were reading out the number of functions you hold, I wanted to record it and show it to my HR training manager, how much you can do training. If MMA is doing so much, we can do a lot more. And I think it's terrific. I mean, this kind of effort, you're an inspiration to all management association. We've been associated with IMA, with Bombay Management and Ahmedabad, but MMA, I think, just takes the cake in terms of the top honors, in terms of the number of work which you do. Suresh, I think it's a delight to hear from you. And, you know, TCS is an inspiration for all of us. And there are two, three companies which really shine there. And I would put Tata Steel as one, certainly because of not, I wouldn't say others are not, but Tata Steel, because it's a place where we were founded. A lot of our heritage values are rooted there. And TCS is a shining star of where we have to go. It's the future. So it's like a guiding light. And every time I visit TCS, any of their centers, I learn a lot. I was in a small center in Powai. I don't know if it is a big center or small. It's a small center. But in Powai, I saw the cutting edge of what retail industry should be in future. I mean, you get educated all the time. But I want to tell you one secret which he has in Siruseri is something I was absolutely blown away. You know, they already have a driverless car in India. You know that they are testing it. It's something which they do all the time. And the terrific anecdotes and terrific stories from TCS, it continues to inspire us. And thank you so much for inviting me here. And Dr. Shashank Shah, what can I say more about you? Firstly, you're a fellow Harvard alumnus, and I think your thing which you mentioned is very critical, that this book was not commissioned by Tata's, it was written by him. In fact, when he came and met many of us, we had a sense of trepidation. You know, generally when somebody who's a journalist, you want to sort of be very cautious, but his own style of interviewing and getting stories out, he just drew all the information and he has put it down very well. And he talks about positives and negatives, and I think many of them are really the way it is. But today I just thought I will speak to you about what I have learned in my life within Tata's. I've not worked anywhere else. I have no other company to sort of benchmark this with or say, you know, experience of that company is this. I can only tell you the experience I have as it exists. And it doesn't mean it's the right thing, it is the wrong thing, but I know this is the only life I know of. Two things which we believe, at least in the group, and I think I'm a true believer of that, is that when you want to set up a great institution, there are two bookends, I call them as two end points, which you must hold very firmly. The rest of the things can keep changing. And that is for you as a person, for any institution, even you know, MMA, these two things are very, very critical. The first bookend is what I call the purpose. And the purpose is why you exist. I think that must be very, very clear in your mind. If you define the purpose, then a lot of other things follow. And the other bookend I call is the culture. The way we will do to achieve the very reason we exist. You know, to do the things which we want to achieve so that we achieve our purpose. Now, within Tata Group, we have very simple words, and this has been constant. For the last 30 years, I can tell you, we've not changed it. And it has been a constant. I hope it remains. We'll continue to refresh and think, but we haven't come at a better way to explain this. Our purpose, we simply say, is to improve quality of life of the communities where we serve. And this is amply written in your book. I think there's a complete chapter. I have a complete list of notes so that I don't misread anything from your book, so that I brought it ready with me. So he cannot say I didn't work hard for this speech. So one is that whole thing about purpose, and certainly it, for us, it is to improve the quality of life of communities and improve quality of life in everything we do. When we touch a business, we first start by saying what kind of impact it is going to have on stakeholders, on consumers, on the suppliers, on the employees, on the users of those processes, so that we sort of improve their quality of life. The second thing is what I call as culture. And culture will beat strategy, culture will beat your planning, everything, because once you build a good culture, then it carries on for forever, into many, many years. And for us, the word which we use to describe our culture, the way we work, is leadership with trust. And the fundamental of the way we want to work is always to lead. We want to be amongst the ones who would be counted finally, which means you really have to be very good at what you do. And the other end of it is trust. Trust is earned, which means the way you conduct yourself must be something which rest of the people feel strongly motivated to engage with you. I think trust is about what people say about you when you're not in the room. And this has been epoxed through many, many anecdotes in our life. And I think when we joined, there was nothing, we didn't know what this word trust meant and how do we earn that. And I remember Dr. Irani one day telling all of us that when I was just very, very young, I'd just joined the group and we were a bunch of youngsters trying to meet him. And then he said, listen, I think I can explain to you what we do and the way we do. Very simply, I think whatever you do, you imagine next day it is appearing as headline in newspaper and your grandmother is reading it. If she will approve of it, then it is a good thing to do. If she's not going to approve of it, then it is not the thing you should do. That is the only test I can tell you. In those days, we didn't have this code of conduct. I think later on, as a group, we went around and we sort of put together a full document, which is called a code of conduct. It is available on the internet. You can read it. And we keep refining it to make it more relevant, more purposeful. But that's the way we work all the time. And that reflects the way we are. And many times we don't do things which others would do, which makes our business building effort a little bit difficult. We always find it others can do things which we can't do. But in the long run, I can only tell you it has made our life very easy and simple. We have got our approvals fastest. I have operated a plant in UP, not a single day of problem. Expansion plan, when I went and met the chief minister, he said, why have you come all the way? It'll be available in your fax machine by tomorrow morning. And it did come next day by fax machine. And this was just one meeting. And same in West Bengal, again, it's in news these days, but our experience of West Bengal has been that we have not suffered a single day of plant being stopped. I can recount an incident when in the port, there was a strike in Haldia port, and the same union, this union leader is the same for all of them. And our own workforce decided that, in support of them, they will also, stop work. The local MP came to our gate and said, everything can stop, but this company cannot stop. And that is a kind of relationship, that's a kind of faith they have in Tatas, because the way we've done is that we don't cut corners and we sort of engage in a way that it is full of integrity. Let me just speak a bit about the company I work for. That is what I know a lot more about. I've worked in hotels, I've worked in motors, automotive sector, and now with a chemical company. Tata Chemicals, for example, the reason it got started goes to the very purpose of the way the Tata Group is, which is to improve quality of life. And I like bring it alive in this whole way we got commissioned as a company. And Sashank says that first 9 years we never made profit. That is true. But I will also tell you what JRD said when he was reviewing the performance at that point of time. We are actually at the very far end of India, at the westernmost tip of India in Gujarat. It is a place called, it's very near to one of the dams called Dwaraka, and it is in a place called Mithapur. Our birth actually happened through a bit of an accident. Swami Vivekananda was a wandering monk in those days. He was touring India. He also went to Dwaraka, and then later on, he went to Baroda and he stayed at the Sayajirao Gaikwad's palace. But Sayajirao Gaikwad was not there when he stayed. But he left a small note for him saying that, I visited this place, which is in the near this temple Dwaraka. But people are very poor, and they have no source of income. And many of them are indulging in wrong practices because they have to feed themselves and there is no employment there. So that's one story. Around that time, the first person who founded this company, his name is Dr. Kapil Ram Vakil. He comes from University of Manchester. He lands back in Bombay, and he's very much, one of the youngsters. He wants to work in the freedom fight, and then he wants to join the freedom movement. So he goes and meets Mahatma Gandhi and says that, I want to join freedom struggle and freedom movement. Tell me where I can go and contribute. And Gandhiji, in his usual self, tells him, you are so highly qualified and you're a doctor from Manchester University. Why do you want to do what we are doing, which is to do political campaigning, work with, you can do a lot more. Why don't you work for economic benefit of this country? So he said, which area I should work? He said, ideally you should go to your state and work in your state. So he wrote a small note for Saijirao Gaikwad to meet Kapil Ram Vakil. So Kapil Ram Vakil went and met with Saijirao Gaikwad. Saijirao Gaikwad remembered this note about these people who were not economically well off. So he told Kapil Ram Vakil, why don't you go to Dwarka and find out what we can do near Dwarka in terms of setting up, what industry can we set up there? Because people need jobs, people need employment. So Kapil Ram Vakil goes to Dwarka, and on three sides there is sea. It is a land which has no rainfall. It's a dry land. It is like a desert. So first he concludes, we can do no farming here. Secondly, he says, what can we do? Because everything is saline. Then he comes with this brilliant idea, and which may not seem, he says, maybe we can, only thing we can make here is salt. So he goes back to Saijirao Gaikwad to say that, listen, I think we can produce salt here. And that's the only proper way of employing people. Thus was founded Oka Salt Works, which was the forerunner of So when Oka Salt Works was set up, it was one of the large salt works, and it came into being because of the munificence of Saijirao Gaikwad. He donated the land. Where our salt works is, it is still a land which is coming from munificence of Saijirao Gaikwad. But he wrote one agreement, which we still abide by, that on the whatever turnover we have, a certain percentage will go as a royalty to the government of Baroda state. Now it is government of Gujarat. It's now transmitted to government. We are only chemical company in India which pays royalty to government of Gujarat, and on all products we make there, not just salt, beyond salt. But that's because of that agreement. But so 6-7 years pass by, and the unit is not doing well, and Saijirao Gaikwad is still funding it. Finally wrote a letter to JRD Tata saying that, can you do something about this unit? Kapil Ram Vakil came and worked with Tatas to put together a plan how to make it more industrialized. What can we do? He also value-added chemicals we can make. So they make a big plan, and then they set up this Mithapur Tata Chemicals as a company which JRD then supported. For 9 years after the Tatas came in, so the Oka Salt Works became Tata Chemicals, the units continued to make a loss. And in a board meeting, several of the board members suggested to him that we must see the writing on the wall. We must call it quits. So JRD made a statement, very profound. It is there in our archives. It is written in our archives. The statement was, wherever we go, we arouse the hopes of people and we will not let people down. And Tata stayed there. And today, I can tell you, it is one of the most profitable units which we run. Gross margins are in excess of 35%. It produces 65% of India's salt. This year has been a momentous year for us. We made 1 billion 1 kg packs of salt, which is equal to 1 million tons. And you can say, what is the magic in salt? But we started with that, and we do really do magic with that product. And it is all because of one person's passion to do something for the country, and JRD's vision to support him and make sure that we didn't walk away from that place. But the basic reason why we started was to provide employment to people in the local area. That was the purpose because of which Saijirao Gaikwad set up that unit. And even today, even though we may not be employing as many people, we continue to run one of the best training apprentice shops. We give employability to people. And many of our local village people are now employed all over the world, including in Middle East, in Southeast Asia, and they're finding good employment. We've gone through several troubled times in the company. And I remember when I joined, when I was sent off to Mithapur to run the unit, we had just made a quarterly loss. The story of Tata is not always everything is running fine. It becomes an excellent unit. It goes through its own ups and downs. But one thing is about the spirit of people, which is to strive to be excellent, is there in every person, which is what I call leadership, the will to wanting to lead. So when I went to Mithapur, one of the first things you do as a site head is to go and meet the union and start to sort of have a meeting with the union leader. That's a tradition. So I landed up in the union office, and I thought it was a meeting with the union office bearers. It was a large gathering like this with about 300 workers standing in front of me. It was a bit of a shock, and I was 36 years old at that time. I didn't know what to do, but then he says, no, doesn't matter. The union leader said, I will speak in Gujarati. You just follow and say something in Hindi if you want. So I didn't even know Gujarati. So the union leader spoke. He spoke at length, and I was sitting next to one of my colleagues, and I asked him, what is he saying? The union leader was telling that, you know, the only way we can succeed is by behaving together as two bulls which are pulling a cart. One bull is the workman, other bull is the management. If we don't pull together in the same direction, we will not survive. Last quarter, we have made a loss. If we continue like this, there is another company, actually it's a well-known company, I don't want to take their name. Their plant had shut down, it is 50 kilometers away. We will be like that plant which is there. And then he said one more thing, that all I am telling management is that we are willing to make sacrifice if the management also inflicts the same pain on itself. All he said was, if it inflicts the same pain on. So I sort of heard it, and I sort of said, it makes absolute sense. So I stood up and he says, look, I fully agree with him that we are two bulls pulling a cart, and we will work together, and this is my commitment. But I still didn't understand what he meant by same pain. So next day I went to office, I called him, I said, listen, I want to understand what you meant. He says, whatever you do, 10% pay cut, you take 10% pay cut. You want to remove 20% of people, you remove 20% from management. Same number. He said, I have a formula which is... And we then went and he spoke about Tata Steel, Dr. Irani. He had run a similar program, and we went and got that same scheme. And we ran it was a generous employee separation package. And we ran it exactly like that. Our workforce reduced from 3,500 to 1,700 approximately. Management staff was 800, it reduced to 400. We kept the count exactly the same. And there was no issue on, in fact, we used to have celebrations, Bada Khana, we used to call it, where separating employees would be, because the spirit with which they left was that they are the ones who are leaving behind the rest so that the company can survive, rather than, so this whole bond about the company is something which drives us, because we believe that company must exist beyond all of us, and it must serve the nation, and that's the spirit with which we worked. Also want to tell you that all is not like this. We also had a category called temporary workers. And here is where I want to say the way the chairman of the group thinks. Now, temporary workers come for about 180 days a year. Permanent workers are there for 365 days. So we had worked out a formula saying, proportionately, they will be compensated for the separation. You know, if they are getting 10 lakhs, these people will get 5. That was the formula we had worked out. And Mr. Tata saw this, and then he said, how can you differentiate? They have also given their sweat. First of all, they're anyway getting less money. So they will get exactly the same formula what you're giving. The compensation will be no less, and ensure you speak to the union, and union agrees to this. We went back, actually union was completely dumbstruck. They said, this is fantastic. I mean, we never thought this kind of a, and I think we gave that package, and in fact, the board supported that move. That tells you that when you want to sort of engage in difficult decisions, you must also be empathizing with people and do it with grace and honor, and which is what we did at that point of time. I can go on and on about many, many incidents which have happened, but all I want to tell you is that fundamentally, these little incidents, when you are sitting in front of great leaders, become a great learning, great inspiration, great source of the way you conduct business. And the book has many, many stories there. I have noted many of them. The story which he spoke about TCS, I think, is a very telling story. in terms of TCS could have listed at the peak of stock market, but they didn't. And this story has been told to me many, many times. And in that piece, when you read it, one of the things about corporate governance we are seeing in the press these days about auditors resigning, about many, many, you know, NBFCs in trouble. So we had this big conference on corporate governance in Bombay, similar to this. And I had, at that time, we had invited Mr. Ishat Hussain. And what he told is still embedded. And in fact, that is also recounted in the book. If you read that, I'm going to leave all this with you so that you buy the book and read it. That's my job here. So there's a very interesting. So he came, we had the current SEBI chairman. He came and spoke at length about law, how law will be tightened, how things will be better. And Mr. Ishat Hussain went to the stage, and he was a finance director after Mr. Sunawala. So he's he was finance director for equally long time. And he said that one thing I want to say, and he used two words in Hindi, which is he said that we are trying to change niyat through sternness in niti, which means you are trying to change the way we behave through very strong laws. We have to focus on the niyat, not on niti. So, and I think sort of penny dropped on everybody said, it is not about, we can frame as many laws as possible, but if our conduct, if our inner beliefs are not right, then we will figure out a way how to break the rule, which is what you're seeing now also with corporate governance. And we always say that we must, so in the group, the entire focus on building culture, building value system is mainly because that then enables us to focus on niyat and not get lost with the niti all the time. Every decision the group has taken, it has been embedded and has been benchmarked on this very principle that we must focus on niyat, not on niti. And one of the other things which I just want to say is that the group always promotes multifaceted leaders. I think we've been blessed with leaders who have been, who didn't have unidimensional view of the world. And you spoke about Mr. Kohli as a father of the IT revolution, but Vishwanathan would know, one of his deep passion is agriculture. And I remember standing in Bombay House, waiting for the lift, and Mr. Kohli came in and he sort of told me, you work for chemicals? I said, yeah. You are in fertilizer? Yes. Come to my office, I want to talk to you about what we should do for Indian farmer. And then he spoke to me about paddy fields and what we should do. And that is about the way we sort of encourage learning. And when you say continuous learning, it is not just learning in your own field. It is learning across fields to open your minds to new ways of thinking. And he was very, very passionate about how can we bring IT to the farmer? How can we use IT as a tool to make sure the Indian farmer actually benefits? And we've been working with our own TCS partners as well as with our own digital team in the company. One of the key things we have started to embark is digital farming completely. And we are also putting up now, for example, one of our vision is how do you make a farmer who has got 1 acre farm and his life, how do we make him a Lakhpati farmer? How can you make him earn? And we now have models which prove that it can be done. And those models are the ones we are trying to sort of move it all over India. So let me end by saying that this entire book, when you read, you will only need to keep two things in mind. I think this is my interpretation, okay? So I'm sorry if I have to come at it with my interpretation. I think the core essence, my learning is, the core essence of any company is to focus deeply on purpose. And Sashank has said that one of the key things about the purpose of the Tata Group is nation building. We call it to improve quality of life and life for the communities where we are present. And at the same time, we also focus on what I call the culture. For us, the culture piece is about leadership with trust, which means we have to lead in every business we are there. We must be excellent in every business, but at the same time, have earned the trust of the people we engage with. That's all I had as a message, but it's a wonderful book to read. And I wish all of you pick up a copy and have a good time reading this. It's very, very voluminous. But that's the secret. You can read it over a long period of time. Paisa vasool. You know, one of the things. No, but I want to tell you this is really. When you ask Netflix about what is the core purpose of their life, they say our purpose is not just to entertain. Our purpose is to actually help you spend time. That is what they say, and I think this is really this book will do. We have come out with a small version now. This is not about his book. We now have a comic version of Tata Group. Amar Chitta Katha has just done for the small kids. It is a very small version, but I think they have done it for their own right. I discovered it yesterday. Sorry, Sashank, this is something I got to know yesterday. I was in Bombay House. Someone got a comic book saying, "Do you want to buy it for your school?" So Amar Chitra Katha has a volume on Tata Group. But yours is not just for school children. Yours is for all of us who are grown-up managers who want to build great institution. Thank you all.
Thank you, Mugan. We'll pass your time. We'll take a few questions. Any questions, quickly tell. Can I pass the mic?
I'll come back to you. I didn't mention anything about Tata Chemicals because the managing director himself was going to talk. I'd like to say a couple of things about the fantastic work that has happened under Mr. Mukundan, which he didn't cover. Firstly, he is among the youngest TAS officers to become the managing director of a Tata company. Secondly, he played a major role in turning around Tata Chemicals at Mithapur, which he shared in brief, but there's a lot more that happened. Thirdly, he was anchoring the team which acquired the billion-dollar GCIP, or the General Chemicals and Industrial Products in USA. And he leads one of the world's most geographically diversified chemical companies with operations in India, Africa, and America, which is Tata Chemicals. And the last point which he mentioned about Paisa Vasool and being very particular about value for money, that's because he heads a company, which is Tata Chemicals, which has the largest customer base in India, because Tata Salt is consumed by 65 crore Indians. That is, every alternate Indian is Mr. Mukundan's customer. So my first question to him, and then you can take it forward. In the recent headlines, and there's a lot of people wanted to know, your dearest baby, which is Tata Chemicals salt business, would now be hiving off to another company as a different business itself. How does it feel? And a little bit on that, if you could share.
So I think every company needs to constantly transform and change. I think this is part of the transformation process. We think this is at the for the shareholders of the company. Again, it's not about whether it's part of Tata Chemicals or whether we think we can do a lot more if we had a much bigger and powerful platform. And we think the shareholders will benefit a lot more. And that was a thinking which the chairman Chandra had. And we fully concur with that thinking. And in fact, I think bringing together the Tata food, which we were focused on, and getting beverage. I think food and beverage go together. You have, you know, in chai ke saath biscuit, something like that people say, with tea, you can have various food items. We were getting more and more into food. And I think bringing them together is going to create a massive, big platform for Indian consumers, but more importantly also, it will create a great value for shareholders. So I think our shareholders will get benefited, Indian consumers will get benefited. And as far as Tata Chemicals is concerned, it is still going to be associated with it, because every pack which will be sold by that consumer company will be made in Mithapur. So it's a 25-year agreement. So we will still have a part of us, but going through a different platform, a platform which is more powerful. And that's really, we see it in a very, very positive light.
Thank you. Thank you. That was the latest company, the Tata Consumer Products Company, which is going to come into existence shortly. I thought that was a very important question. All would not know. Yeah, sure.
Good evening, Dr. Shah. Actually, we've been talking about, you know, various groups of Tata companies. About the West Bengal shifting the Tata Nano from Tata West Bengal to Gujarat. You can talk about it something. That is very interesting and time-bound.
Sure, sure. I have captured that in great detail. There's a whole chapter on the Tata Nano story, especially the series of events which led to the ideation of the Nano itself. So when I interviewed Mr. Tata, I asked him, what is your greatest success as a chairman and what is your greatest failure? So Mr. Ratan Tata said, my greatest success and my greatest failure is Tata Nano. And I asked him why. And he said that Nano has achieved that for the Tata Group, which no other product or service in the last 100 years has achieved for the group. Because the kind of visibility and identity that Tata got in innovation, in engineering, in business excellence through Tata Nano across 100 countries over the globe as a company which is manufacturing the $2,000 car is without a parallel. It was considered as an invention after Ford's motor T, exactly released a century earlier. So that was, and the biggest failure, we know what, it didn't do well commercially. But he shared that also, is that because we've misjudged the customer's expectations at the base of the pyramid. People at the base of the pyramid don't want doles. They don't want handouts. They don't want price-sensitive products alone. They want products which will also enhance their prestige, which is something we miss and usually presume that that's only for the middle class and the elite class. The people at the base of the pyramid who can afford are happy to take a loan and then buy a car, rather than buy a car which is tagged by the media as the cheapest car. I think that was the biggest disservice which happened to one of the best innovations, because the Tata Nano has almost 70 to 80 design plus technical patents to its credit. So that was one thing he mentioned. Talking about the shift, I've covered that also in detail, all the politics surrounding the Nano's movement from West Bengal under the left government, the Banerjee-Bhattacharjee battle, as I have called it, what happened between the left and the right and the center as well, and how the Tatas were in the tight spot, and then what kind of patience they had, and at what a tipping point they decided that they can no longer risk the lives of the laborers who were working at the Tata Motors plant there, because there were physical attacks and assaults on them, and then how they shifted from there to Gujarat, and the business sense of Mr. Modi, who immediately capitalized on the opportunity. And I've written in my book, the moment Mr. Ratan Tata announced that he's moving out of Bengal, Singur, I believe, and that's there in the press, Mr. Modi in those years sent an SMS to Mr. Ratan Tata, which said Swagatam, or welcome. So it was a direct invitation for the Tata Motors plant to be relocated from Singur to Sanand. But the whole logistical efforts they have made in dismantling a plant and reconstructing it 1,500 kilometers away is also a management practice without a parallel. And I had a long conversation with Girish Wag and his team, who is now the president of Tata Motors and who was the project director for Nano, as to how they very scientifically dismantled the plant and very scientifically used almost 95% of that in Gujarat, in Sanand, to reconstruct the plant. The only big loss for the Tatas was that this transition led to about 18 months. They had 2 lakh fully paid orders for Nano. The Pantnagar plant in Himachal Pradesh could manufacture only 30,000. And in these 18 months and the delay of manufacturing 1,70,000 cars, the media was agog with rumors, many of which were recirculated by the competitors and international companies, which Mr. Tata has also mentioned in several press conferences. And Nano lost out on the advantage it would have had. I've covered that in great detail.
Actually, it's very good to listen to you and about Tata Group, you know, nation building first.
Thank you.
But I want to ask you, how far Tata Group is comparable to the level of patriotism displayed by Japanese counterparts? You know, that's one thing.
Level and of what?
Japanese.
Patriotism.
Japanese. And my second question is, if majority of the entrepreneurs, you know, in India, I have very bitter experience for the last employer I had in India, Madras itself. But they're very exploitative. No, I don't want to name the company. But majority of the companies like your Tata's, you know, then India will be heaven like thing, you know. Why it is not being followed in other corporate sectors? What steps you are taking like that? These two things.
Correct. So, sure. Question
is to Mr. Mukundan, partially to Dr. Shashank also. The entertainment industry, Suresh Malle is my name, the entertainment industry, film industry in India per se, is about $3.7 billion business by 2020. Now, and it is very much an unorganized sector it is coming from. Why not Tata's get into the film industry, so it become a very corporate structured industry, and by means 1/3 of the tax will come back to the government also, and you will get more structured people, quality people getting into the industry. So you please reflect it in your internal board meeting, and next time when you write another book, please ask this question to all the directors and kindly cover this. Yeah, please.
Okay, so I'll answer the question in the orders they were asked. First, I'll ask the second question of the first gentleman about what can be done so that the employers are not exploitative. I see it historically, I'll quickly cover it in 30 seconds. See, historically, India has gone through three clear cycles. One is the British Raj, second is the License Raj, and third, now they call it as the Billionaire Raj, which symbolizes the inequities between the haves and the have-nots. The transition, especially the License Raj period, was a very tough time for corporations. And the mindset was shortcuts, black economy, tax evasion, and trying to see whatever they can do in order to survive and make the most of it so that they can pull through. I think some of those traits, despite the kind of growth in the economy, the transparency, the globalization, the flexibility that has come in, the old mindset hasn't gone. In terms of real growth being sustained, we need two or three things. One is we need a free economy, which we've had for the last 25 years. And the proof of the pudding is that the moment the economy was freed, India has really shone in the global market and has risen to become the third largest economy in purchasing power parity, which was unimaginable 25 years ago. Secondly, is what we need, a good and transparent tax system. And I gave you the example of Tata's paying 47,000 crores. If we have a transparent and comprehensive tax system, the kind of social welfare measures the government wants to take will become far easy to execute, because there will be lesser and lesser cases of the kind of shortcuts we are seeing people taking today. And thirdly, we need to encourage entrepreneurship and highlight powerful examples in India. The biggest problem of our business schools is that students are taught from Philip Kotler and Michael Porter, and the mindset of the business students today is that the great management practices are only in the West and India is no good. The fact of the matter I would like to share is, in my experience at Harvard, institutions like Harvard, Stanford, INSEAD, MIT and several others teach about 100 case studies just on the Tata Group companies, 100 case studies. So it is one of the most studied business groups in the world at the Ivy League institutions. And I've quoted from that research also in my book. My endeavor, and hence you ask, what can we do? My endeavor, I think, at least as management subject experts or authors, is to throw the spotlight on the kind of success stories we have in India, where you can do well by doing good, where you can make money while also being conscious of your responsibilities towards the stakeholders, and where you can be purpose driven and also profits driven so that the right people can be attracted and nurtured in that particular organizational culture. I think that is lacking. Endeavors of the millennial authors like me are more and more to bring out this India pride. And I think this sense of pride for the country and its success and how it can be a model for other developing economies in Latin America and Africa is increasingly reflecting. A Standard Chartered report says by 2030, India will be the world's second largest economy at 45 trillion, China at 64 trillion, and US behind us at 31 trillion in purchasing power parity. And Mr. Adi Godrej's recent article, he mentioned that by 2050, India will beat China and become the world's largest economy. So we are talking about India no longer known as the slumdog millionaire, but India which is going to be the largest economy in the world in 100 years since its independence. So if these examples are put forth, this is what others will learn from. You can only inspire, you cannot force certain things. The question on for how much time it took for me to write the book, the writing part, about 9 months. But as I said, it took me almost a decade to interact with so many of the Tata leaders. And I never started thinking that, okay, I'm doing all this so that I will write a book. It was a part of my research, doctoral, postdoctoral, and then I realized that there is a huge gap in narrating the Tata story as a great business house, not as a philanthropic institution. And that's when I started working with a greater focus. As far as films is concerned, I'll let Mr. Mukundan answer. Yes. I do have some inside knowledge, but Mr. Mukundan should.
No, sorry.
Let him,
sorry,
he's coming to chair. MMS, he'll tell you.
Yeah, I think we will have this debate about which kind of companies, you know, Japanese, Korean, American, we've had that. But I think each one brings its own plus and minus. But coming to this whole issue of, you know, entertainment industry, we are pretty much there in terms of streaming. We are pretty much there in terms of delivering the content. We are not doing the content ourselves. If you look at Tata Sky, If you look at Tata Communication, I think there's a convergence game, there's a delivery of content which we will do. But yours about specifically about entertainment, I think there are a few industries, and he highlights in the book, which we have said no to. We don't want to be in sin industries, we call them tobacco and alcohol. Entertainment may not qualify there, but we have very, there's a clear view that we don't want to be in that industry. You should read the book. And in the book, there was one attempt made by a company which used to be called Tata Press. They did go with a proposal to finance an industry, and the Tata Sun said, please don't do it. When they didn't listen, we sold the company. So if you do, one of the things which Sun's exercises control over companies is not just through the brand name, but also if you don't listen to what they have, they can certainly sell your shares to alternate buyer. You won't be part of the group. So one of the things of needing to be in part of the group is to be in the sectors which this will change. This may change. We don't know in future. So we have to keep our minds open. What we have started to do is to actually do animation. Tata Elxsi, which is a sister company of TCS, does a lot of animation. If you see Matrix, if you see Avatar, all this were done in Bangalore in their office. The entire animation was delivered by them. So we do an animation in terms of all the Hollywood movies, including Bollywood movie. I'm told even the latest ones which have come out, bulk of the animation is done by them, but we don't make the content.
One last question. Yes.
My name is Chowarna Chair, President of 75 years old Tamil Chamber of Commerce. I want to share with you, for Mr. Shashank, that one incident happened in the Chennai port board meeting, 135 years old Chennai port. I was the board member of Chennai port. One of the communist leader and a member of parliament, he was also in the board at the time of 2 years back, 2-3 years. There is a proposal to lease out a piece of land to one of the communication tower erection of some other company. When the chairman presented it, the communist leader opposed, giving 10 minutes blasting that how you could give this piece of land to that company. For 10 minutes he spoke blasting. After that, completing his speech at the end, he told that leader's member of parliament also still is alive. If it is given to Tata Group, it is okay. They are doing business ethically. That is the remark made by a communist union leader, member of parliament, for this Tata Group, which I want to share with you.
So I'll just add to that, which I've mentioned in the book. One of the public sector iron and steel companies approached Tata Steel, saying that why don't we get together on a joint venture? If I collaborate with you, then I will have easy clearances from the government of India. The government of India has a greater faith in the Tatas than a public sector company, and hence the public sector company wants to collaborate with the Tatas. So I'm not surprised. That's a constant feeling across several parts of India.
Thank you, Shashank. Thank you, Mr. Mukundan. I think we can carry on. When you listen, 150 years story, you can't finish in 1.5 hours. Ladies and gentlemen, a big round of applause to our brilliant speakers. Very inspiring. I think each one of us going to go out of take today very get inspired, learn so many things, and practice some of this thing in your own life, or not in company, your personal life. I think you'll be a great citizen. May I request Suresh Raman to please present a memento on behalf of MMA to board the issues. Yeah, you can buy the book, and Shashank has kindly signed, autographed the book. Have a great evening. Till we meet again tomorrow. Bye-bye. Good night. Get back home safely.